Good afternoon, everyone. Perhaps we should get started. So panel two, the second and final panel of today's workshop. I'll just briefly introduce our speakers, and then we'll get straight to it. So first we have Dr. Justin Gengler. He's a research program manager at the Social and Economic Survey Research Institute at Qatar University, where he heads the CESRI policy unit. He received his PhD in political science in 2011 from the University of Michigan, and his research focuses on mass attitudes, political behavior, and group conflict in the Arab Gulf states. He is the author, most recently, of Group Conflict and Political Mobilization in Bahrain and the Arab Gulf, Rethinking the Rentier State, which came out in 2015 by Indiana University Press, and he will start with threat perception and regional identity in the Arab Gulf states. So, Justin, over to you.
Thank you. So, I'm Justin. I'm coming from the Social and Economic Survey Research Institute at Qatar University, which is a social science survey research institute. We do public opinion surveys, essentially, of people in Qatar and to some extent throughout the GCC, and work with some other cross-national projects such as the World Value Survey and the Arab Barometer and some other things that you might have heard of if you study public opinion in the Middle East. So when Fanar asked me to take part in this workshop, I was a bit worried that my paper, which is based on some results of some of these surveys, might not fit very well, sort of because the method is different, but also in terms of substance. But I think now that we've had the first panel, that's definitely not the case. The paper looks at how people in Qatar and across the GCC perceive threats, nation-state threats, but also non-national threats, sort of changing threats both from actors or groups, but also sort of policies or other phenomena like economic changes or crises, depending on how you view the oil price decline in the region, which really speaks to this issue of why do people now call themselves Sunnis, right? I mean, it's sort of interesting question of, I don't know what, psychology or anthropology, whether or not any group ever started calling itself something in the absence of some other group, right? Because it doesn't really make sense. And Fanar's emphasis on the 2003 Iraq invasion, I wouldn't say I disagree with him necessarily, but I think in the Gulf context, arguably more important even than that, in cementing this Sunni-Shia distinction, it was the uprising in Bahrain and the subsequent intervention of Saudi Arabia and the Arab Gulf states to essentially quell that mass mobilization, which I think brought home much more in a much more real way, the potential threat of Iran from the standpoint of Saudi Arabia and the other Gulf states, and brought it essentially to their backyard, right? I mean, it's no longer in Levant, it's now in Bahrain, and it could be in the Eastern Province, and it could be in Kuwait, and it could be a lot of places. So I think certainly the Iraq invasion set the motion for hypothetically what Shia majoritarianism could look like, and in Bahrain, in fact, there's this famous dossier produced by someone that was later leaked, written by an Iraqi scholar called On the Situation of the Sunni Sect in Bahrain. It was written in 2006, and essentially made this argument that if certain steps are not put into place at the national level, that the natural trajectory of demographics in Bahrain and politics are such that it will turn into, in the long run, another Iraq, essentially, given the majority Shia population in Bahrain. But again, that was all sort of theoretical until you had 2011 and the progression of uprisings that looked to sort of becoming very close to the GCC states or the non-island GCC states. So against this backdrop, I'm looking again at how people in the region, so not how governments in the region, we've talked a little bit about how governments sort of perceive these sorts of threats and how maybe the position of governments and the position of citizens is not always aligned, or there may be some lag between the two, as we heard in the case of Jordan from Morton. But in this case, we're actually using the actual views and opinions of people over time and also across countries to see if we can make out some empirical patterns that might help explain the rise of semi-identity or the change in thinking that underlies this rise. Right, so these are some new data, most of them that are collected not directly by my institute. We have a large cross-national project that funded survey collection across the GCC. The only GCC country that refused to participate in the survey was the Arab Emirates. They're essentially not doing any social scientific surveys anymore. And data from Bahrain and Saudi are literally on their way now. So this focuses on the results from three countries, which is Qatar, Kuwait, and Oman. And I'll talk a little bit about some preliminary findings from these surveys in terms of changing dynamics in threat perceptions and what they mean for this project, which looks at the larger question of semi-identity from a sort of historical standpoint and a wide geographical lens. So since 2011, when there was a mass uprising in Bahrain in the very early days of the uprising in Tunisia and Egypt, February 14th, and so you know very soon after the original events in December, hundreds of thousands of people gathered in the streets. It was the largest modern uprising in the history of Bahrain. And only 2 weeks after that date, Saudi ground forces crossed over from the eastern province and were supported nominally by some other GCC countries and very quickly imposed martial law and put into place a system of military courts to try people who were accused of participating in the uprising. There were retributions against Shia who were suspected of participating in that those protests, including mass layoffs, mass firings, jail terms for opposition leaders, the razing to the ground of 50 or 55 Shia mosques. And until then, the situation, or since then, the situation is essentially stagnated with a very polarized society, a society that's even more polarized than it was when I was there for fieldwork for my PhD in 2009, which is saying something. It's a island the size of a small English county, I think is the way that one linguist put it. And there are two distinct dialects of Arabic. So that tells you something about the degree of segregation of those communities that over several hundred year period, those two dialects have never merged, right, simply because of the segregation. So we have this event unfolding in 2011, which really set into motion, I think at least, the wider Iran hysteria in the GCC, this larger regional rivalry between Saudi Arabia and the Islamic Republic in various theaters that would then crop up afterward in Yemen and Syria and in Iraq again. Another regional dynamic which since 2011 is notable and that comes out in these data is the Gulf rapprochement with Israel. We talked about, or maybe it was in a paper that's not been presented yet, but it was in one of the research notes, the idea that one of the focal points in politics in the Arab region for at least the last half century has been Palestinian-Israel question. In the Gulf, at least, this is no longer a really relevant political question in terms of the ordinary citizen, and that comes out again in these results. And so we have this elite concern over Iranian interference. Iran was essentially accused of being the mastermind of the uprising in Bahrain and similar protests that spread to the eastern province, not only by Saudi Arabia, but by all the GCC countries, sort of stepping in line behind the main partner in that relationship. Also by the United States military, for example, not always by the United States State Department, but certainly by the US military. And certainly by outlets like Al Jazeera and other news media, which really hammered home this idea that Iran was this malevolent actor in the region that was looking to retake Bahrain as its lost province, but also more generally to sort of make problems where it can in the Gulf states and to sort of undermine their position. I was in Qatar at the time of the Bahrain uprising, and speaking with colleagues, I was very surprised by, despite there being very few Shia in Qatar, maybe 5% of the population, it's one of the smallest Shia populations in the Gulf, people were at least as anti-Shia as they were in Bahrain. And I was thinking, well, there's no local threat. I mean, how could you be opposed to a group that really presents no challenge, which gets to the issue of sort of ideological challenge versus a security challenge that hopefully we'll be able to talk about. So it raises a few questions. Have citizens internalized this elite concern or internalized the sort of international relations of the region, of the GCC? To what extent is there any one view of Iran or the threat posed by Iran, or one orientation towards sectarianism, or are there important differences across countries? And how do people, how do Sunnis especially, view Iran, a Shia actor, and the sort of challenge that Shiaization of the Gulf poses versus other Sunni Salafi actors, such as Islamic State, which gets back to the issue discussed already of there being a sort of, let's say, other side of sectarianism, which is the anti-Salafi or anti-sectarian sectarianism. Okay, so to say a little bit about the actual data themselves, to the extent that people are interested and sort of care, this is a cross-national survey project of large and nationally representative samples of GCC citizens. So this is not just going to malls or something like this, this is the actual scientific public opinion surveys. The questionnaire is focusing on regional identity and attitudes toward GCC political and economic integration. So it's actually the larger backdrop of the project is looking at another form of identity that's emerging in the region, which is a Gulf identity, Khaliji or something like this, which I think has very strong Sunni overtones. I mean, I think it's almost synonymous with Sunnism. You wouldn't think of someone identifying themselves as Khaliji and Shi necessarily. I think there's some incongruity there, I think. And then in addition to these data that we have from different countries at the same time in 2016, which gives only a limited picture of views given that it's relatively recent and happened sort of a few years after the Arab Spring and the Bahrain Uprising and other things that set sectarianism in the Gulf into motion. I also look at some data that we have from Qatar since 2010. Qatar's an interesting case. I mean, it might seem like a sort of small and maybe not very representative case on the one hand, but on the other hand, it's a country that has a relatively homogeneous Sunni population with a very small Shia population. And so if you imagine that there are these sorts of views in Qatar, then it sort of gives you a bellwether of where things might stand in these other countries. And it allows a new analytical approach to existing work on threat perceptions in the region, which tends to be very qualitative, based on interviews or based on media quotations, for example, the Shia Crescent, right? This is the sort of thing that always has to be quoted when you're talking about sectarianism. And also gives a citizen perspective rather than an elite perspective. So hopefully we'll be able to see these things, at least on these big charts. You guys have nice screens. So these are threat perceptions among Qatari nationals going back from 2010 till 2016. And what we see, I guess the what looks like white is supposed to be yellow, but hopefully you can still see it, is a marked shift over this period. On the left-hand side, we have Iran. Then we have Israel, United States. These are other Arab countries, including GCC countries. And then the final category is none. And this means that somebody said no country poses a threat to Qatar. The way this question asked was an open-ended question, so it wasn't just giving people a choice between these countries and saying, oh, which of these countries is the biggest threat? It was just name what country do you believe poses the greatest threat? So people could say answers that don't even make sense, like Americans or the EU, and they would be disqualified. But I mean, the point is that we weren't leading them to any one answer. And so obviously the first thing that pops out is between 2010 and 2011, the proportion of people who identify Iran jumps by two times the amount. It continues to go up until peaking more or less in 2012 at around 60%. So in 2 years, it's gone from about 18% to 60% of people identifying Iran as the greatest threat to Qatar. At the same time, Israel over this period has gone down to essentially nothing. It's gone down to being the most identified threat in 2010. You asked someone in 2010, which country? The number one cited country is Israel. Now it's gone down to zero. The United States has sort of lingered around a similar proportion. There are other interesting things to say about that, but I won't hear. But what you also find more recently is the increased importance of other Arab countries. So fellow Arab states as posing threats, at least in the Qatari context, and maybe that's because of interventions by the Qatari state and perceived blowback from that. Arguably the most important trend, though, I think, is the proportion of people saying no threat has gone from almost half the population, or almost actually exactly half the population in 2010, to only 20%. So whereas 5 in 10 people said that no country poses a threat to me as an individual or to the country, now only 2 out of 10. So regardless of which country they think it is, overall, perceptions of security have really declined in that period. And so I think this is some sort of empirical evidence of what we've been talking about this whole time, which is that people are feeling the pressures of changing security dynamics in ways that makes them think about sort of who are my friends, who are my enemies, and that sort of thing in different ways than in the past. So this is just a summary of some of the findings. And then if we look across the GCC, we have these same categories, although I've now disaggregated the GCC countries from Arab countries generally here. And we see important difference between Kuwait, respondents in Kuwait, or Kuwaiti nationals, Qatari nationals, and Omani nationals. In the first place, Oman stands way on its own. I mean, maybe that's not surprising given the foreign policy orientation of Oman, sort of officially neutral in conflicts and that sort of thing. But in Oman, Iran is almost the least cited threat of the countries. Israel is across the board not identified at all. And in fact, Western countries, fellow GCC countries, and fellow Arab countries are much more likely even than Iran to be cited as posing the greatest threat to Oman. On the other hand, Oman also has the highest proportion by far of people perceiving no external threat. So in general, the picture you get from Oman is a citizenry that feels relatively secure, but to the extent that they're not secure, it's from fellow Arab countries and GCC countries where the threat comes, and not from, you know, traditional satans like the US and Israel and this sort of thing, and Iran. In Kuwait, the picture looks relatively similar to Qatar, although in Kuwait, the striking thing is the proportion of people who perceive no external threat. I mean, maybe it's because they're adjacent to Iraq. There was a bombing that occurred in the summer before the survey, so that might have had something to do with it as well. But only 2% of people in Kuwait said they perceive that no country threatened them. So essentially, everybody in Kuwait thinks that some country at least poses a threat. You see the spike for the Arab category, which presumably is Iraq, given the spillover effect from what's going on there. And Iran is very similar to Qatar. We weren't able to ask about sectarian affiliation in the survey just because of sensitivities and that sort of thing. Also in Kuwait, it's a bit different just by going visual because it's hard to do. But what you find is that despite the demographic differences in Kuwait and Qatar, the proportion of Kuwaitis, despite having more Shia, actually more likely to identify Iran as the main threat compared to Qatar. So it's not simply that, well, okay, if you ask Shia, they're going to say Saudi. If you ask Sunnis, they're going to say Iran. I mean, there's something else going on.
We don't have a breakdown of Shia, Sunni, and Kuwait. The 60%, half the percentage is Sunni Kuwaitis.
No, exactly.
You don't have it?
I don't.
Okay.
But I'm saying the Kuwaiti population is around 30% Shia. So even if it were the fact that Shia overwhelmingly...
But they might identify the other. Sorry.
Yeah, sure. Okay. Sorry. No, we can talk about that. And then finally, because I know I'm running out of time, we have state versus non-state threats, right? So even if 70% of people, let's say, in Qatar or 60% of people in Kuwait identify Iran as the greatest state challenge to the security of their country, how does that weigh against other threats, some of which are coming from fellow Sunni ideologies, or, I mean, depending on how you want to consider Salafism, but certainly things that are not emanating from Iran and are much more closely linked to their own countries and their own traditions than elsewhere. And so when you ask people to select between these four options, in this case, we did actually give a choice, so it wasn't simply an open-ended question, you find that across the board, the spread of Islamist terrorist groups such as Daesh and Al-Qaeda are identified as being much more of a threat to the security and stability of the GCC region than Iran. And in Oman, in fact, both, well, not oil prices, but interference from Western countries and almost also the economic issues related to the drop in oil prices are on par with Iran. And so what it really gives you is a picture not only of important differences across countries, important differences over time, but is contrary to this idea that Iran is perceived uniformly as a real threat to the GCC region, to GCC populations. And when push comes to shove, people are at least as worried and probably more worried about the effects of some of their own, let's say, internal forces within the Sunni community, even if maybe that's a fringe element of the community, than they are the direct threat, the direct security challenge from Iran, which speaks to the difference between ideological threats and sort of ideational challenges to Sunni supremacy or whatever it is, versus a traditional military or security threat, which I think will be useful to disaggregate from the standpoint of this project. So again, emerging state threats are seen as emerging non-state threats seem to outweigh the challenge from specific countries. Islamic State's clearly the top threat among all three groups. Iran's a weak second in Qatar and Kuwait, and Oman's third behind Western interference. And overall, then, there are big differences in specific and overall threat perceptions among GCC countries. Traditional threats are being overshadowed increasingly by perceived challenges from Arab and GCC countries. And in Qatar and Kuwait, there's some tension, I think, you can identify between the view of Iran as the most problematic state actor and the view of Daesh and the spread of Sunni Salafi Islamist terrorism as the greatest overall threat to GCC security. So that's all I have, and hopefully this will continue to, despite the different, let's say, method involved, continue to inform the rest of the talks today and what we've heard already this morning. Great, thanks.
Thank you. Just out of curiosity, what sort of numbers are we talking about? Maybe you mentioned that now.
In terms of respondents?
Yeah.
Around 1,000 in each country.
1,000, okay.
Yeah.
So for each bar would be 1,000 respondents. For each country.
Each country, there are 1,000 people were interviewed. Yeah, okay. Exactly.
Very interesting. Thank you very much, Justin. So our next speaker is Dr. Mark Farha. He obtained his PhD from Harvard University in 2007, where he also served as a head teaching fellow with distinction. From 2008 to 2015, he served as assistant professor of government at the School of Foreign Service in Doha, Qatar. He is a fellow of the University of Bielefeld. Am I pronouncing that correctly?
Bielefeld.
And was a senior associate member at St. Anthony's College, Oxford, in 2013. In 2015, he was appointed as an assistant professor of politics at the Doha Institute for Graduate Studies, where he teaches courses in Arabic on regional foreign policy, political economy of the Middle East, and Arab political thought. His scholarly publications have focused on the origins of secularism and sectarianism in the Middle East and Lebanon in particular. He has lectured in English, Arabic, and German at universities such as Harvard, Columbia, UCLA, Addis Ababa, Tokyo, and now Singapore.
Singapore as well, yes.
Okay. So without further ado, Mark Farha with the impact of the Rafiq Hariri era on Sunni identity in Lebanon.
I just want to praise Justin for his empirical work today. Unfortunately, I'm going to be a little bit more, superficial in some ways, and I hope not too superficial after this jet lag. But I want to look at the figure of Rafiq al-Hariri insofar as he represents something which is bigger than Lebanon in many ways. Hariri, as you may not know, was a Saudi citizen as well, and he was a symbol for I think what we called, you know, today maybe the moderate wasati Islam, Sunni Islam, that a lot of people fear has gone, you know, missing right now. And the broader question he poses to me as an intellectual or as a historian is the idea, and it goes back a long time, of whether the profit motive, that is capitalism, can overcome identity or confessionalism. Voltaire, and I think I have a slide somewhere there. Oops, how did I go there? Sorry, this way? Oh, yeah, here. Voltaire here, you know, can't read it, but he has a quote from way back when he says, go into the Exchange of London and you'll see that, you know, all the religions are assembled there and get along because they're engaging in capitalism, so to speak, in trade, in profitable trade. And that, you know, truism of sorts or maxim was very much embodied by Rafiq al-Hariri. He, you see it there, for instance, however, maybe in an ambiguous way, the mosque there in the center of Beirut, which he built towards the end of his life, a humongous mosque, which on the one hand was constructed in a very sort of, as you probably may know, urbane, modern, central Beirut, but which also represented, if you want, the Sunni, Saudi intrusion upon what was traditionally it was a Sunni city, but also there was a Maronite church right next to there, and the Hariri Mosque dwarfed that church. So some of the Christian old families of Beirut were very much antagonized by this symbolic act. So that's one side of him. Some people accuse him of being a Saudi agent, which he was. He was a Saudi emissary when the Saudi ambassador embassy was closed in 1982. Hariri became the official mandub, or emissary of Saudi Arabia and Lebanon. But they accuse him of bringing that petro-Islam, if you want, into Lebanon, the Salafi, if you want, to some degree, Islam, Wahhabi Islam. I think that's, of course, you know, does injustice to the man, because, of course, he himself many times, for instance, said that the honest Christian is closer to me than the bad Muslim. So most of the advisors were Christian, a lot of them. It's ambiguous, to put it this way. If you ask me, is capitalism colorblind in the case of Rafiq al-Hariri, I will give you the answer of my presentation right now. The answer is in German, Jein, yes and no. Hariri never fully cast away, if you want, his Saudi, and that for that matter, Sunni baggage, if you will. He didn't become a secular person 100%. But on the other hand, he also was somebody who definitely would have been appalled by Daesh and the likes. So let's just pass in review how this all happened. Aristotle is going very far back, but we're looking about origins of things. When he speaks about the Phoenicians oligarchy, the Carthage, he speaks about the fact that they only respected people who had money, that only rich people could rule. And Hariri very much said the same thing. He said at one point, what's wrong with me being rich? Why can't a rich man not be the prime minister of Lebanon? So there we go. He was eventually, as you all know, assassinated in 2005. And this recalls to me something before. There was a Lebanese leader in 1635, which is a coincidence, who had a similar kind of mercantile orientation, who was also assassinated, also, they say, by Syrian, or in that case, certainly by Ottoman and Syrian hands. In Hariri's case, Syria is the target or the accused. And that is important in what way? Basically, what you had prior to the assassination of Hariri, and here we get into the topic of the day when we're talking about sectarianism. And I was there in Lebanon, and I saw it myself, and it was very clear, of course, for everybody who knows the situation. You had two projects. You had, on the one hand, Hariri, backed by Saudi Arabia. You had the then President Lahoud, who was Maronite, and a lot of other politicians, backed by Syria. In a one way, you could say you had the project of the military state of Syria against the project, if you want, of Lebanon as a globalized, Western-oriented, in this case, sponsored by Saudi Arabia, of course, state. And how did that come about? Well, traditionally, the elites in Lebanon, the old elites, oops, I hope I'm going the right way here, the old elites were of feudal nature, landed elites, and today we only have maybe Jean-Claude, if you know him, the Druze leader, who still, to some degree, hails from that landed elite from the 16th, 17th century. You had a mercantile elite, which was established in the 19th century, often with French aid, ties to colonialism, etc. Then a banking elite, which basically established the state itself. Michel Chiha, a famous banker, was the one who wrote the constitution. I just wrote an article on this. He wrote the constitution single-handedly. And then, and with some people alluded to this before today, beginning in the 50s, in fact, there was one Ouaini, first prime minister, Sunni prime minister, was supported by Saudi. But then, of course, by the 70s, you have the petro oligarchs, if you want, the Gulf contractors, who were not necessarily all Sunni. I mean, there are a lot of Christian ones as well, people who made it big in the Gulf. But in general, this is what allowed Rafik al-Hariri to break through the traditionally Christian, if you want, elites of Lebanon. He did that by also buying up a lot of banks, Mediterranean Bank and others, and he did it in an interesting way. And here's something interesting. There's a phase in Lebanon before the Civil War, no, during the Civil War, when Hariri was trying to establish himself as the preeminent banker against a Christian elite led at that point by someone called Roger Tamraz. And Roger Tamraz and Hariri were fighting each other, and Tamraz was warning Lebanese, watch it, the Saudis are coming here, and Hariri is their man, which was true, of course. And but it's he gave it a confessional kind of bent. Of course, later, Hariri kind of reconciled with these guys. And Hariri, how did he get around that? He went to Paris, to France, and bought a bank there, bought another bank in London. So basically, he leveraged global capitalism, in a way, to eclipse or to short-circuit the Lebanese confessional system. To this day, by the way, this is something he couldn't break quite. A lot of the wikalat, the the agencies in Lebanon, 75% of them were in the hands of Christians. So the wikalat al-hasriya. So if you want to import a Chevrolet or a Cadillac or anything like this, you could only go through certain families. And these were usually, you know, Christian and Maronite and Greek Catholic families. So Hariri tried to get through that and succeeded to a large degree. By the time he became prime minister in 1992. And so we have that. So this old hierarchy in Lebanon, whereby the Maronites and the Catholics were constituted the majority of the upper class, was kind of, this is 1974, 1975, I would say with the advent of oil, etc., the Sunni, parts of the Sunnis and even parts of the Shia who benefited from, you know, remittances from Africa, etc., could sort of undercut this traditional hierarchy. And you have the demographic shifts, which I'm not going to go into now, but basically, as you may know, the Christians are dwindling and the Sunnis and the Shia are becoming by far the majority of the country. And I've written an article on this. And you have this traditional troika in Lebanon where Hariri basically was, in his years, overshadowing these two other figures to a large degree, the Christian president and the Shia Speaker of Parliament. Basically, between you and me, he kind of bought them off. And he could do so for a long time until in 2005, it seems, because of also the regional situation, and I would also submit because of the situation in Iraq, the Iraq war definitely created a sectarian milieu, it created direct sectarian implications for a country like Syria with all the refugees, and Hariri was a friend of Alawi, the kind of and the more secular strands in Iraq, was already struggling with this, I think. So I think the Iraq war, the Hariri assassination, and then the Hezbollah war with Israel in 2006, each of these, and Justin probably document, and I will document it with Pew numbers as well, led to an increasing polarization between Sunni and Shia. As you well know, Hezbollah was respected even by Sunni Lebanese for a long degree, to some degree, not every Sunni Lebanese, but by a majority of them prior to the Hariri assassination. With the Hariri assassination, it really, really, and the Iraq war, if you want, but the Hariri assassination really, really broke it. And then the 2006 war was a further blow to the popularity of Hezbollah, and we'll see that later in polls, which I will show you. And this was the idea of Hariri. Hariri wanted to bring, he said at one point, a Singapore of the Middle East and another instead of a Saigon. that is, you know, a country where Lebanon would be a country of entrepreneurship, of finance capitalism, and of services rather than of jihad. I don't know why that happened. What happened, however, by doing so, Hariri increased the national debt. You see that here, manifold. What is more, of course, that he owned some of the banks which were benefiting from the very high interest paid on Lebanese bonds. On the good side, the Solidaire, the center I was talking about before, was reconstructed. It cost about, I think, $6 or $7 billion, which you might think is a lot of money, but it's not a lot of money compared to, say, the $10-15 billion spent on electricity, which is not Hariri's portfolio primarily, and which didn't result in anything. So for at least with Hariri, you know, something was done to create something. However, this is where I get to it in terms of his backing. When he wanted to establish himself as the prime minister of Lebanon, he had to create a base. He was not from one of the feudal families. He was not from one of the traditional strong families of Beirut. So he had to go outside of Beirut to Saida. And so he had to engage in charity and philanthropy, of course, with a Saudi backing, which he did. But that was not necessarily colorblind. It favored the Sunnis. And as soon as he established himself as a prime minister in 1992-93, he shut down his foundation, more or less, because its purpose had been served to create the base.
What's the source for this?
I have it in my paper. In my paper, all the numbers, it's a different, there's somebody who did a study, not myself, but somebody else did a study on this. I forgot who it was, actually. It's in the paper. So this, what you see on the right, is just is another thing of sort of the ambiguity of Hariri. On the one hand, he was a Sunni Zaim. On the other hand, he was the father of the nation. And when he died, you see there, you see the flag of Saudi Arabia. You see the flag of the PSP, the Socialist Popular Party. And you see even the flag, I think, of the Lebanese forces, etc. So all these contradictory, and this is the Timthal al-Shuhada, the martyr statue in the center of Beirut. So he was appropriated by different parties as they saw fit. And the chasms between rich and poor in Lebanon went, and this is something, of course, I think if we look at the broad picture about why sectarianism is happening in the Middle East in a very broad sense, I think we cannot but relate it to the stratification we're seeing around the world. Why do we have militant nationalism in Europe, in America, in Philippines, in India, in Russia, in, you go down the list. It's not just a Middle East specific thing. It's, and in the Middle East, it becomes sectarian because that's the identity that, that are, you know, enracinated in the society. I can go into this a little bit. Why hasn't there been a revolution in Lebanon? I think there's a lot of reasons I can give you for that if you want to look at that. But let me just see this. When Hariri was killed, there was this huge demonstration, as you may know, the biggest one in Lebanese history, similar like in Bahrain, 1 million people, but it was still based on sectarian leaders. And Hariri himself, in one interview once with the cardinal, the Maronite cardinal, Sfeir, justified naturalizing, it was a very controversial decree, naturalizing about 300,000 citizens, well, not citizens, they were Syrians, Palestinians, Bedouins, etc., because he said we're naturalizing more Sunnis than Shia. So this would indicate that indeed Hariri did have a sectarian kind of project in the back of his mind as well, and of course that cannot be completely dismissed. With his assassination, 2005, you had, as I was saying before, a popular mobilization, but it was a mobilization which was still based along the old lines of sect. You had the two camps, which are still dominating Lebanon today. I don't know, this is not working, okay. And even though people kind of marketed it as the Arab Spring, I think it was undermined by these confessional trenches. And it was, you know, Iran versus Saudi, and we have the whole situation going on till the present day. If you look at surveys who killed Hariri, it's very clear. The Sunnis were a little bit divided at that point. They thought either the Israelis or the Syrians, and the Americans or the Syrians and the Lebanese. But today, I think the Sunnis would say maybe to 90%, this was done right after it, would probably say the Syrians did it, right? And at that point, it was still, these are the accused, There's still evidence. This is something I wanted to show you. This is not very clear maybe here, but here you see it black on white. One, of course, the views of Hezbollah, how they, what I was indicating before. I think if you go a little bit before that, it's even more clear that the negative views of Hezbollah have soared almost everywhere across the region. And I would say in Lebanon in particular, before 2007, before 2005, Hezbollah's negative views were maybe in the 30s or something, 20s, and now, and then it increased markedly after that. But this is very interesting. Yeah, okay, so that's that. Okay, let me just go to the last one because I want to. Okay. This is something, sorry, the slides are a little bit thin. Okay, yeah, there's this whole, I don't know if you saw the Seymour Hersh article in 2007, where he claims that the U.S. had a plan, and there's a lot of evidence, of course, of this, to leverage Salafis and jihadist forces in North Lebanon, in particular, against Hezbollah. After 2006, when the Israelis tried to kind of neutralize Hezbollah militarily and kind of failed, there was a second strategy, which is to kind of use internal Lebanese sectarian forces, that is the Sunnis of Lebanon, to rile them up. And this was even tried by, you know, Israel in 2006. If you remember, Saudi Arabia came out in the war very strongly condemning Hezbollah. But it didn't quite take root. They went a further step, and some people affiliated with Hariri were involved in this as well. The Israelis came out openly and said, of course, that they support the Sunni axis against the Shia axis more than once. And so this is as well something I think that is in the witch's brew, even though Israel is no longer seen as an enemy there, partly because Israel is kind of allied right now at this point with the Sunni states, although that might change at some point, we don't know. Let me quickly go to the end because I don't do. So to me, the whole problems that you had with Hariri, and a lot of people say this about Hariri at the end, they say the man was too big for the small country of Lebanon. He tried to play a role on the global stage. He tried to establish himself as a leader, not just of Lebanese Sunnis, but of moderate Islam across the region, showing this new paradigm. Could he do so in light of the bifurcations we have between Iran and Saudi? Remember the Taif Accord, which Hariri played an essential part in formulating, was the result of a rapprochement between, if you want, Syria, Iran, Saudi Arabia, America, and Russia. Now, if America and Russia, if Saudi and Iran are at loggerheads, how can somebody like Hariri survive, a moderate figure in this polarization? It is very, very difficult to see that. So I think in that sense, he was a victim of circumstance. I just wanted to show you the last graph with the, this is not working very well. You see the Emir of Qatar and Erdogan, who at one point were also trying to have the mantle of moderate Islam, and they're trying to now square the circle, if you want, by reaching out even to Russia, which seems counterintuitive in one way, but in another way will be probably the only solution to avoid a further conflagration in the region. Because, you know, a lot of people say that what happened with Hariri's assassination was the destruction of this kind of moderation that we had in the region. Here we go. This is an interesting statistic. This is a question: do you support sending arms and military supplies to anti-government troops in Syria? I think this was done around 2014. And what is interesting here, what caught my eye, is that even Sunni Lebanese opposed that. So you see that here. And that is very striking in light of the fact that I think, you know, Gulf states probably would be more inclined to support that, and has partly to do, I think, with the fact that they're close, but also that Lebanese Sunnis in general, if you look at all kinds of surveys, whether about questions about religion and state, for instance, they will be the most pro-secular, if you want, of all Sunnis in the whole Middle East, partly because of reasons of education, of cohabitation with Christians, etc. So, but I think that is something to bear in mind as sort of a little flicker of hope, maybe, amidst all the gloom and doom, that in Lebanon you do have quite a large base of moderation. Now, Hariri, one of the reasons people accuse him of having failed is that he was too focused on Beirut geographically and on finance and services, you know, in terms of macroeconomics, rather than productive enterprise, rather than the margins of Lebanon, agriculture, et cetera. So a lot of people were left out. And those left out regions are the ones that now his son is having so much trouble in controlling, whether it be in Tripoli or Saida and all these marginalized regions. Some of the poorest groups of Lebanon are the Sunni Muslims outside of the center of Beirut. So it's an ambiguous picture. I think if you'd have to give a sort of a report card of Hariri, I think he did present an alternative, but the execution was hampered for many reasons. Part of it has to do with global capitalism, and part of it has to do with the increasing polarization, sectarian polarization from Iraq and in the region at large. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mark. So political science at Sciences Po Paris in 2011. In 2013 to 15, he was a Max Weber Fellow at the European University Institute, Florence, and we're all very jealous of him about that. He was also a postdoctoral researcher at Paris Saint-Denis University and a part-time lecturer at the Institute of Political Studies in Grenoble in France in the field of history of political thought. His research is concerned with the history and development of Salafism, with a special focus on how the quietist approach to Salafism has impacted Western, particularly French youth, and has gone global over the last few decades, mainly from Saudi Arabia to the rest of the world. He has published Du Golf au Banlieue, is that correct? Le Salafisme Mondialise, yes?
Mondialisé.
Almost there.
I like your French accent.
Thank you very much. He's also edited a volume dealing with the foreign policies of Islamist movements, Les Islamistes.
Islamist and the word.
There you go. Anyway, he's published many things in French, which I will stop trying to pronounce.
Your accent is gorgeous.
Thank you very much, sir. Without further ado, the Sunnization of Saudi Arabian foreign policy from transnational Islam to transnational Sunnism. Hamad Ali.
Thanks to all of you. Well, I think I'm going to be even more superficial than our two first speakers. So what I'm going to do is try to provide with a general overview. Do you hear me? Yes. Is what's going on when we talk about Sunnization of the Saudi Arabia foreign policy. So basically, in 15 or 20 minutes, what I'm going to do, or try to do, is to highlight, let's say, the main turning points, you know, in the global Saudi Arabia foreign action, especially when it comes to identity framing, and even more specifically when it comes to the mobilization of religious discourse. So first of all, we all know that from a so-called pure religious perspective, to be a Sunni has been referring over the last centuries to the proximity to Quran and Sunnah as the main sources to Islamic belief and worship, frequently opposed to Shiism and Shias, to whom Islamic truth is principally located in the biological successors of the Prophet Muhammad. Sunnism and Sunni scholars have historically distinguished themselves by favoring the scriptures over individuals and human beings. If, for instance, Muhammad's companions, or Sahaba and family members, are outstanding religious figures, what needs to be discussed, first of all, according to the Sunnis, deals with how Muslims have to reach out the truth, and this needs to be achieved through the mastery of God's word and his messenger's model. So as a result, there can be no truth incarnate in one human being. Although this attempt to define Sunnism is quite summary and would greatly need to be redefined on the basis of a rigorous historical analysis, what I'm going to focus on in this presentation is social identity building, and more specifically how religious and symbolical boundaries are manipulated in order to become political and even more exclusive and radical. This idea that primary identities, being a Muslim, being a Christian, being a French, being a Singaporean, is quite become really important when they are facing the issue of social and political perceptions, like today in the Islamic world, or even for the last several decades, is according to me extremely useful, as it allows to go beyond the notion of manipulating beliefs and identities, which is actually quite a strategy-oriented approach, since we assume, or we tend to assume too often, that actors may easily separate their interest from their identity. In fact, I tend to focus on the fact that there is a big part of self-conviction, and even sincerity in most actors' political conduct. Values and interests are interconnected and influence each other, as the constructivist frameworks, you know, in international relations theory have been teaching us for a long time. When it comes to the issue of the framing and the role of Sunnism in Saudi Arabia foreign action, and what appears to be a growing place of this concept in today's Saudi foreign policy, we need to keep in mind that discourses and symbols mobilized by actors depend on specific configurations. So to end up with this introduction, what does matter is identification. I use the word identification rather than identities. And in the case of Middle East politics, the nature of competition. In this perspective, what does matter is not so much what the founding national identities are supposed to be, but who your enemy is and how you decide to react to perceived threats, you know, as Justin, you know, told you. The perceived membership in a relevant social group on the basis of perceived group status differences, and the idea that a specific behavior corresponds to a delimited feeling of belonging to one group are the key elements through which the rise of Sunni identification, not identity, and categorization processes need to be understood. To end up with this introduction, it turns out that the concept of Sunnization of Saudi policy is quite relevant to some extent to get the meaning of the geostrategic configuration within which this state has had to go through since several decades. As a relational positioning being increasingly focused on its Sunni identity has to be replaced in the framework of the regional rivalry with Shia Iran, but not only Shia Iran, I will go back to this, or more precisely, perceived Shia Iran, echoing to the construction of a major threat for the Saudi leadership and security. Eventually, I would make another point regarding the impact of this religious and political landscape on the issue of construction of Sunnism itself. Indeed, I will try to demonstrate that there is perhaps a more relevant concept to understand the current process seeking to achieve a restored Sunni identity. So the restored Sunni identity leads me to consider the notion of identification and not identity, uniting Saudi Arabia and all the Sunni players in the region, which can be called, you know, as trans-Sunnism or political Sunnism, that I can define as the coexistence of several forms of Sunnisms, plural, collaborating in the framework of a shared political interest, but without a clear religious content or any desire to convert the whole Islamic world to the Saudi religious vision. So basically what I'm going to focus on are two points. The first one that I'm going to try to elaborate is the social and political construction of a Sunni reaction to some perceived threats, you know, several decades, or since, you know, has been the case for several decades. My first thing is to highlight the fact that Saudi Arabia has been highlighting, first of all, you know, has been moving from a kind of Islamic identification to a Sunni framing or a Sunni identification. The Sunni contract, referring to a state-driven form of Salafism, we have been discussing this morming. In the meantime, it is a cleric-supported regime. We have, let's say, two pillars, as you know, at the head of the Saudi states. So the monarchy or the royal family, or the monarchy, the Saudi family mainly, you know, heading politically the regime or the society and the state. And on the other hand, you know, let's say the so-called pure religious source of authority, which are the clerics, you know, divided into several bodies. That you have, for example, the Hayat Kibar al-Ulama, the Committee for the Grand Scholars, Islamic Scholars, which is the main religious institution at the head of Saudi Arabia. So it is the very core identity of the state. But the fact is, when it comes to the foreign policy, Saudi Arabia has been focusing on defending and promoting Islamic causes all over the world, since, you know, right since, let's say, the second part of the 20th century. So, for example, we know that, you know, according to or depending on, you know, its enemies, its adversaries, you know, the Islamic discourse, the Islamic reference has been more or less, you know, mobilized. We know that, for example, in the 50s and the 60s, you know, opposing to Nasser regime, the Arab socialist, you know, Nasserism, you know, we Saudi Arabia had supported, you know, the founding of, for example, foundation of some institutions like, you know, the Islamic World Islamic League, you know, born in this in 62, and, you know, to another extent, you know, the OIC, Organization of Islamic Conference, now it's Cooperation, you know, in 69. So junction in the search of a bigger soft power for the Saudi state and greater religious influence, you know, soft power for the state-driven part of the Saudi policy, and more religious influence for the religious or the clerics, you know, driven part of Saudi policy, you know, has, you know, hugely impact the state foreign action. But also, you know, in terms, not only in terms of state action, but also in terms of more private or semi-official, you know, institutions. With a huge network of officials, semi-official and frequently private support to the spread of this vision of Islam, Salafism or Wahhabism. In order also to defeat, you know, other, let's say, adversaries, you know, the Islamic influence, not the Sunni influence, and I'm going to return to this idea of Sunnism. You know, the Islamic, you know, symbols, you know, Islamic discourse has been mobilized, you know, in order to struggle with, challenge the Western influence, you know, we all know that, you know, communism, of course, Western influence, and so on and so on. And more, so we have no, let's say, clear evidence that before 1979, of course, religiously, we have some, let's say, scriptures, some texts, you know, from the Saudi scholars, focusing on the fact that Shiism or Shias are, Shiism can be considered to be a kind of heresy, you know, a non-Islamic heresy, but there is no clear evidence that we need to bring, you know, to support politically Saudi Arabia as a state, you know, as a religious, you know, as a ulemacracy, you know, as a two-pillar system, need to support, let's say, anti-Shia fight, you know, on a more geopolitical perspective. But things change, you know, and we, domestically, we have, you know, the fight, or the, let's say, the destruction or, you know, policy, a domestic policy against Shia rituals. For example, you know, in the eastern provinces of Saudi Arabia, in Qatif, for example. But there is no clear evidence, no clear support of an anti-Shia geopolitical fight before 1978, 1979. So the fact that from a, let's say, a social science perspective, the idea that this Islamic policy or trends or pan-Islamic policy has turned out, you know, to be a more anti-Shia policy, so which basically means in this framework, you know, a more Sunni-oriented policy, is clearly connected to the rise of the Islamic Republic in Iran after 1979. So the idea, for example, that the king, so the Saudi king, you know, took the title of the custodian, you know, of the holy places, the Islamic holy places, the two sanctuaries is clearly connected, of course, to a domestic threat. We know that in 1979 we had this Juhayman al-Taybi's, you know, movement, you know, who tried to cover, you know, Mecca, so which more a, let's say, jihadi or very radical Sunni, you know, movement. But in the same time, you know, this Wahhabism, this state of Salafism has turned into a more officially anti-Shia, you know, policy after 1979. So the idea, you know, that Iran tried to engage and to legitimize, you know, Saudi historical influence has clearly impacted the fact, you know, that Saudi official, Saudi clerics, you know, the Salafi clerics, you know, have promoted a more anti-Shia and Sunni discourses. For example, I give you a very, very interesting illustration. There is no fatwa from the Grand Mufti of Saudi Arabia before 1979 showing or highlighting the fact that Iran was a kind of targeted enemy. It was a Shia majority society, we all know that, of course, but, you know, this absence of revolutionary dimension in the Iranian foreign policy impacted actually no reference, no pure religious reference in terms of fatwas, for example, from the Hay'at Kibar al-Ulama at that time. But after 1979, we have fatwas. I can give you several ones, but there is, for example, you know, and it's increasingly the case, I mean, since 1979. In the 80s, in the 90s, of course, today even more. You know, the idea, you know, that the Rawafid, the renegades, for example, are extremely dangerous to authentic Islam, to Orthodox Islam, is a founding pillar, you know, in the religious discourse. So these first references to Sunnism as a core element in the Saudi entity and a source of international mobilization are framed, you know, since it's also extremely important to note that, that it's framed in terms of anti-Iranian and anti-Shias, but note at that time at least, in terms of pro-Sunni mobilization. So it's like, you know, these actors, first of all, the religious actors at the head of the Saudi states, you know, their ulemas, they have understood or they fear the fact that they should not emphasize too much their Sunnism. So for example, they say that they defend authentic or genuine Islam, not Sunnism. But there is a key difference actually because, you know, over the last few years, especially, you know, since 2000, because we have what I try to argue is that between 2003 actually and the war in Syria, so almost one decade, reference to Sunnism, you know, have been growing. That will be the end of my first part. So this idea that, you know, there is a growing influence of a more Sunni-oriented and Sunni, you know, Sunni-designed foreign policy is extremely important. But the fact that, you know, this decade or almost one decade from, since, I mean, from 2003 to 2011 and afterwards, you know, because of the war in Syria, is a turning point, you know, when it comes to justifying Saudi Arabia foreign policy in terms of pro-Sunni mobilizations. We have fatwas, we have discourses, we have this idea, you know, from the clerics on the one hand and from the religious, from the Saud al-family, on the other hand, you know, that this aspect of their identity is increasingly mobilized in order to challenge, you know, this so-called or, you know, Iranian influence. The second part of my presentation now is going to address the issue of a trend Sunnism or political Sunnism or rise of political Sunnism. To understand, you know, and to be a bit more, let's say, nuanced when it comes to address the issue of Sunnization of Saudi Arabia foreign policy. First of all, we need to address it in terms of a two-level game. I would oppose in this perspective the notion of sociological or cultural Sunnism to the notion of political Sunnism. What I try to say is that, of course, when it comes to mobilizing with other, let's say, Sunni countries, I mentioned the fact that the GCC was in partly designed to challenge, of course, the revolutionary Iranian, you know, influence. But there is no way, actually, in terms of to understand, you know, this this issue, it's more Sunnism in terms of a source of transnational mobilization when it comes to a very specific configuration. The idea, you know, that Saudi Arabia is trying to build to Saudize Sunnism is extremely relevant and interesting when it comes to Saudi Arabia and some other countries. But what I have to say, is to highlight the fact that it doesn't work for all the Sunni societies all over the world. The case, for example, of the cooperation or the partnership between Saudi Arabia and Morocco, which is another Sunni majority country, is also very interesting. So when it comes, for example, you know, to military mobilization, like for the war in Yemen, when it comes to geopolitical or diplomatic mobilization, there is, or it seems to be at least today in these specific configurations, with the rise of Iran, you know, as a regional power in the framework, of course, of the Arab uprisings, of Israel-Palestine, of the Western influence, of Syrian war, of course. There is this idea that there could be, you know, a kind of Saudi-led Sunni coalition in terms of diplomatic efforts, in political and geopolitical efforts. But when it comes to cultural Sunnism, you know, or anthropological Sunnism, it's far less relevant. As you know, we have cases of oppositions from countries like Egypt, for example, Morocco, of course, you know, these countries wanting to keep a kind of primacy, domestic primacy, when it comes to the definition of Sunni identity. I'll give you one example. In 2012, the king of Morocco, Mohammed V, insisted on the fact that this country was a Malikite, was following, used to follow the Malikite, you know, rituals, the Malikite school, and there was no way, you know, of importing another kind of Islam, whatever it was. So you may understand, of course, that it's a declaration against, of course, you know, Shia and Shiism, for example, because we have this fear also, this domestic fear, even at the other side of the Arab world, of a growing influence of Shia communities, of course. But there is also, it was also a way to re-emphasize the fact that Moroccan Sunnism was quite different from Saudi Arabia definition of Sunnism. The same for countries like Egypt, for example, you know, with Al-Azhar, of course, you are not surprised. We have mentioned this morning the conference, the Grozny Conference in 2016, in September 2016, wanting to challenge, you know, the attempt, you know, to Saudize contemporary Sunnism. So my last point will be, are we going for a kind of competition for Sunni primacy? So we also need to keep in mind that it's not only about states. We have, of course, for example, Saudi Arabia, as I mentioned already. Countries like Turkey and Qatar supporting the Muslim Brotherhood, you know, Muslim brothers, you know, all over the Arab world and even beyond. So the idea that there could be one single form of Sunnism, at least, you know, in terms of religious construction, religious identification is very, very, it needs to be really discussed. It needs to be even, you know, challenged. But the idea that there may exist, you know, kind of political Sunnism, at least for this specific, you know, moment, configuration, needs to be discussed. And it's much, according to me, much more relevant when it comes, you know, to alliance building and regional identification. So once again, it has to do with the fear of Iran as a revolutionary threat, of course. And this threat is turned into, of course, religious and denominational categories. But this idea of, you know, the Saudization of Sunnism in terms of religious, pure religious construction, is not so relevant when it comes, you know, because we need to acknowledge that there is a clear diversity, you know, in the Arab world, the contemporary Arab world. And I think I'm going to end with that. I lost my way, but well, I apologize. I hope I was more or less clear. Thank you very much.
Thank you.